Good morning.
Good morning.
I almost forgot that we were going to start church while we were here today. It's so exciting to see so many faces that I kind of got busy visiting. I know that's a surprise, but that's what happened. And regarding the face masks, we at this time are saying that if you feel safe without one on, okay, that's great. If you feel that you still want to wear a mask for whatever reason, and we don't need to know the reason, you do what you are comfortable with. And nobody's going to judge anybody either way. So just to let you know, that's where we're at this point, and hopefully we'll be able to continue going forward with that, that we don't have any bumps in the road with this. But if we do, we'll adjust accordingly. That's how we will handle this. So, does anybody out there have an announcement? I, of course, have a few that I will do. Okay. First of all, there is a box on the table just outside of the sanctuary that is for Interfaith Care Center. Whatever items that you have, usually like hygiene items, various items. In fact, I think, did we post that at one time recently, that the items that they needed? Was that in our Facebook?
It was in the newsletter.
It was in the newsletter. Because they did have a list of items that they're kind of looking for. I also remember puzzles was one of them. I would imagine it gets a little boring to keep redoing the same puzzle over and over. So any type of item that you have that you think they might be able to use, if you want to bring it in, put it in that box. Somebody that is in the church fairly often will bring it to them. And if the box gets really full, you can say, Linda, you know, you could bring those to Interfaith, because the last bunch I was supposed to bring in is like, oh, look at that, they're still sitting there. So if it seems like they've been in the box too long, you could remind me that I need to get that done. And speaking of Interfaith, I talked with their chaplain this past week, and at this time they said that they will allow us to come back in and do our Sunday service the first Sunday of the month. So the first time we will be doing that is June 6th. And in the past, that has been the members of the visitation team, but the visitation team can always be more people. It isn't any special requirement. The only reason we call ourselves that is that so if we're scheduling something, we know who to call to let them know we're going to do something. So if anybody is interested in being a part of that, you could talk to me, to Joanne, to Lynn. I don't think Ron and Betty are here, but they're also on that team. So if you have any interest in that, please talk to one of us. And we are going to be redoing the gardens by the bell tower, and then the garden that's out here, the faces Highway 210. And we need to get those areas clean. The flowers are actually coming on June 18th, so we would probably be planting them the following week. So we need to get those areas ready for the flowers. And at this time, I'm not going to say we're meeting on a specific day, because whoever would like to come and help with that, if you could give me a call and we'll try to arrange a date rather than me saying this is the only day we're going to do it. I don't want to exclude anybody that might be able to come at a different time. So please just give me a call if you're interested in being part of that. Anything else that anybody has? Okay, then I think I'll let Lynn give you a little message about an upcoming meeting.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So this is our second announcement. We need to do 3 in a row. So we'll hold a special congregational meeting next Sunday, the 23rd, immediately following worship. That will be to vote to call Seth Winans to serve as our pastor, and also to vote to accept the salary benefit compensation package proposed by the council. So both votes would need to pass. And unlike a regular meeting, we have to have a two-thirds majority for the vote to pass. So we'd like to have as many voting members here next Sunday as possible, so everybody has a say into hopefully calling a pastor. So hope to see you all there next Sunday. Thank you.
Lynn, how many is that you need?
just repeat that in case it didn't come over our Facebook real well. Lynn was saying that, first of all, we need to have a quorum present, and that's 10% of our baptized members. And then, what did she say? Now, two-thirds of that number need to vote one way or the other for it, either to pass or not pass. And 25 is our 10%, which would be quorum. And that's a fairly small number, but that's what our constitution says. But you can certainly have more people here than 25 or 24, and that would be great. That'd be wonderful. For one thing, now that we don't have masks on, if we're feeling comfortable without them, we get to see people again. So that'd be great. So hopefully a number of people are able to come next week. I also will state right now, just in case I lose my voice completely, I am dealing with a lot of allergy stuff right now, and I know this is true of many, many people out there, but one of the things that I end up sometimes having is laryngitis. So for me to not be talking, you'll know that something is wrong, because that's not normally me. So just to let you know. So let us now continue our service with Son of God, Eternal Savior. Shower us with light. To you be given all praise with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Gracious and glorious God, you have chosen us as your own, and by the powerful name of Christ you protect us from evil. By your Spirit transform us and your beloved world, that we may find our joy in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We will now have our readings.
Morning.
Morning.
Today's reading is from the first book of John, chapters 5, verses 9 through 13. God has borne witness to the gift of eternal life in Jesus Christ. Whoever believes in the Son of God believes in the witness of God and has the promise of eternal life. If we receive human testimony, the testimony of God is greater, for this is the testimony of God that he has testified to his Son. Those who believe in the Son of God have the testimony in their hearts. Those who do not believe in God have made him a liar by not believing in the testimony that God has given concerning his Son. And this is the testimony. God gave us eternal life, and this life is his Son. Whoever has the Son of life, whoever does not have the Son of God, does not have life. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Today's psalm is Psalm 1. We will read responsibly. The Lord knows the way of the righteous. Happy are they who have not walked in the counsel of the wicked, nor lingered in the way of sinners, nor sat in the seats of the scornful.
Their delight is in the law of the Lord, and they meditate on God's teaching day and night.
They are like the trees planted by streams of water, bearing fruit in due season, with leaves that do not wither. Everything they do shall prosper.
It is not so with the wicked. They are like chaff which the wind blows away.
Therefore the wicked shall not stand upright when judgment comes, nor the sinner in the counsel of the righteous.
For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked shall be destroyed.
Please stand for the gospel.
Alleluia, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Alleluia.
The gospel today is from the 17th chapter of John, verses 6 through 19.
Glory to you, O Lord.
In this reading, the church hears Jesus' words on the night before his death, his prayer for his disciples and for all who would believe in him through their words. I have made your name known to those whom you gave to me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you, for the words that you gave to me, I have given to them. And they have received them and know the truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I am not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one. While I was with them, I protected them in your name that you have given me. I guarded them, and not one of them was lost, except the one destined to be lost, so that the scripture might be fulfilled. But now I am coming to you, and I speak these things in the world so that they may have the joy joy made complete in themselves. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. I am not asking you to take them out of the world, but I ask you to protect them from the evil one. They do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. As you have sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. And for their sakes, I sanctify myself, so that they may also be sanctified in truth. Praise to you, O Christ. You may now be seated, and we will have the sermon.
In the name of the Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Here's a question for any of our women who've been mothers. Do you remember your favorite gift that you ever got at a baby shower? A woman named Louise Kramer tells the story of opening gifts at the shower for her first child. Among the necessities and toys, Louise found one very special gift. It was a baby quilt hand-sewn by her grandmother, who passed away years before. As Louise marveled over the beauty of the quilt, it hit her that her grandmother had planned this quilt and spent weeks stitching it together long before Louise ever got pregnant. Louise writes, she probably knew as she basically stitched it that she would never meet the child for whom she was sewing. Motivated by love and faithfulness, Louise's grandmother planned for this very special gift for a future great-grandchild she would never see. I thought of this very special gift when I read our scripture passage today. This passage relates to Jesus' last major prayer before his arrest and crucifixion. Our lesson from John's Gospel is often referred to as the real Lord's Prayer. It's the one in which Jesus prayed for his friends, the apostles. Jesus knew that his ministry and his life were both drawing to a close. He had already submitted himself to the Father's will. He knew that his arrest and trial and very public, very humiliating, very violent death would throw his apostles into a turmoil. I mean, put yourself in the place of Jesus' friends. Imagine seeing Jesus' arrest and torture and death through their eyes. Wouldn't you be overwhelmed by grief and fear and questions and doubts? I know I would be. And so, Jesus did a miracle to save his own life and continue his ministry. Nope. Obviously, Jesus did no such thing. And so, Jesus appeared to his apostles with a host of angels around him so that they would never again doubt his divine nature. Again, no, he did not. And so, Jesus supernaturally took his apostles with him to heaven so that they wouldn't have to suffer in any way because of their faith in him. There again, no. I mean, Jesus could have done all those things. They were all within his power, but they weren't God's will for him or for his followers. They weren't what God sent him to earth to accomplish. Jesus provides us the perfect example how to align our choices with God's will, even if God's will is frightening and difficult and hard to understand. That's one of the primary purposes of prayer. To develop such a loving, trusting relationship between us and God that we naturally align ourselves with God's will. And so, Jesus, in his last hours on this earth, did what he had always done throughout his ministry. He took his concerns to his loving Father in prayer. Jesus prayed for others. He prayed for his disciples. And then prayed for all those people he had never met. People who hadn't even been born yet. Generations of people yet to be born who would come to believe in him as their Lord and Savior. In other words, in his last hours on earth, Jesus prayed for you and for me. What an incredible gift of love. There's a true story that Admiral William McRaven of the U.S. Special Forces Operation Command tells of his training as a Navy SEAL. One technique that the SEALs practice regularly, according to Admiral McRaven, is how to perform underwater attacks against enemy ships. It's a grueling and risky operation. Two SEAL divers are dropped off at night
that they 2 miles away from an enemy harbor. With only a depth gauge and a compass, the two divers must swim at least 2 miles underwater in the dark to reach the enemy ship. But this isn't the hardest part of the mission. The hardest part of the mission is when the divers have to dive below the ship to the very center of its hull. Underneath the huge steel ships, there's no light whatsoever. The divers must complete the rest of the mission in total darkness. It's only because they prepare so thoroughly beforehand that they are able to operate with total skill and composure in the dark. Admiral McRaven concludes his story by saying, "If you want to change the world, you must be at your very best in the darkest moment." Our Bible passage today shows that Jesus was at his very best in his darkest moment. He was calm, he was confident in his Father's love and his Father's plans for him. In fact, he was so confident that Jesus barely felt the need to pray for himself. Instead, he prayed for his apostles, who would be left behind to do his work. He knew that they were weak and scared and unprepared, just as we would be weak and scared and unprepared under similar circumstances. And that is exactly why prayer is the first and best cure for dealing with our own dark moments. Author and Nobel Prize winner Alice Munro wrote that her mother prayed on her knees every morning, afternoon, and night. She began each morning with prayers to be open to God's will. She ended each day with prayers for God to examine her thoughts, actions, and words that day. Munro claims that one benefit of faithful prayer is that nothing can happen to you that you can't make use of. Even if you're racked by troubles, and sick, and poor, and ugly, you've got your soul to carry through life like a treasure on a platter. Think about that for a second. When you maintain a regular, faithful communication with God, God will reveal to you wisdom that means nothing can happen to you that you can't make use of. Even suffering and sorrow, fear, doubts, God's wisdom and perspective will allow you to make use of your worst moments, just as Jesus did in our Bible passage for today. So, imagine once again that you're one of Jesus' friends, the disciples. In their presence, Jesus prayed, thanking God for them and praying for their well-being. Jesus' prayer was startling and breathtaking. Having learned so much from Jesus as they traveled with him for the better part of 3 years, perhaps what stuck with the disciples most was how he prayed. In fact, at one point, they asked Jesus to teach them how to pray, like he did. And you'll recall that Jesus taught them a model prayer that we know today as the Lord's Prayer. But in that day before his crucifixion, Christ prayed for his friends. It's always reassuring when we're going through difficult times to know that someone else is praying for us. Pastor Bill Hybels tells about an interesting experience at the baptismal service in their church. He stepped into the church stairwell to find a woman there crying. The woman admitted to Hybels that she was struggling. It was her own mother who had just been baptized. So why the tears? Because the woman confessed, "I prayed for her every day for almost 20 years. The reason I'm crying is because I came this close to giving up on her." After 15 years of praying daily for her mother, the woman asked herself, "Why am I wasting my breath?" At the 19-year mark, she considered giving up. The woman admitted that her faith was weak, that she wanted to give up on her mother meeting Christ and making a commitment to him. But after 20 years of daily prayers, unanswered prayers that mocked the woman's faith and caused her much frustration, after 20 years of faithfulness, in spite of her weaknesses and her doubts, this woman's mother finally received Jesus as her Lord and Savior. We sometimes forget how powerful a simple prayer can be. Do you pray for your friends? Jesus did. And you know what? In the same way that Jesus prayed for the apostles, he prays for us, for you and for me. In times of confusion, when we're unsure of what to do next, it's a great comfort to know that Jesus is praying for us. But how did he pray? What did he ask for? Jesus prayed that God would help his friends remain strong. That's always an appropriate prayer, the prayer for strength. Pastor E. Stanley Jones once wrote about two men praying. One prayed, "Lord, please help me to hold on." The other prayed, "Lord, please help me to let go." Have you prayed either one of these prayers lately? I think we can all relate to them. Each one requires a different kind of strength. Ellen Peach writes, "There are two types of strength. There is the strength of the wind that sways the mighty oak, and there's the strength of the oak that withstands the power of the wind. There's the strength of the locomotive that pulls the heavy train across the bridge, and there's the strength of the bridge that holds up the weight of the train. One is active strength, the other is passive strength. One is the power to keep going, the other is the power to keep still. One is the strength by which we overcome, the other is the strength by which we endure." Jesus' prayer is a great reminder to us that God never intended us to suffer and struggle through life on our own strength. We have limited strength, you and I, limited wisdom, limited perspective. Our circumstances sometimes look more powerful than God's love for us. Through prayer, God wants us to restore our strength, deepen our wisdom, and elevate our perspective. Jesus knew the cost of being one of his followers in those days. He knew it would be high. He knew there would be times when the disciples' lives would be in danger. He knew there would be times when they would be tempted to run. Notice that Jesus didn't pray that they would be released from their problems. Instead, he prayed for them to be strong. What a prayer. Strong enough to withstand the challenges that lay ahead. Jesus didn't pray for escape. He prayed for victory. He prayed, "I'm not asking you to take them out of the world, but I ask you to protect them from the evil one." In 1943, as he was preparing, along with his division for the Allied invasion of Normandy in World War II, Private First Class William Kiesel wrote to friends that he did not want prayer for his safety, because safety isn't the ultimate goal, he said. The goal, he stated, was true exemplary conduct. Apply that to your own life as a follower of Jesus. Safety isn't the ultimate goal. True exemplary conduct is. Private First Class Kiesel added, "What is important is that whatever does happen to me, I will do absolutely nothing that will shame my character or my God." Let me repeat that. He says, "What is important is that whatever does happen to me, I will do absolutely nothing that will shame my character or my God." That sounds very much like Jesus' prayer for his friends. He could have taken his apostles to eternal life with him. He could have taken away their struggles and their suffering. He didn't. The struggles and suffering were absolutely necessary for the power of God to work through them. They were an essential test of faith that convinced Jesus' followers of the faithfulness and truth and power of God. It was their faithful witness in their suffering and struggles that built the Church of Jesus Christ. The one prayer that God always answers is a prayer for strength to endure. Jesus prayed for the apostles so that they would find strength during their time of suffering. That was a prayer that was answered time and time again. It's a prayer that some of us have prayed as well. God is faithful. He will not forget us in our time of need. So today, we're reminded that Jesus prayed for his friends. He prayed that they would be strong. He also prayed that they would be united. He prays, "Protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one." That's such an important message for us. We're not simply a collection of individuals, you and I. We are the body of Christ. It is so vitally important that we in the church pull together, that we're united. Too many things can disrupt the unity of the church. People get upset with the decision of the church board, or people get upset with the pastor. Jesus knew that it was not easy to maintain unity among a talented yet sometimes cantankerous group of people. He also knew, however, that we can never accomplish the things that he's called us to accomplish if we don't pull together. Unity, well, that doesn't come easily. It requires humility, requires a shared vision, and most of all, Unity requires prayer. When we align our will with the will of God, when we align our character with the character of Jesus, then we will operate in the spirit of unity. And we can accomplish the work of Jesus on this earth if we can just learn to work together. Bottom line, today we are reminded that Jesus is praying for us. He's asking God two things on our behalf. First, he's asking that we shall be strong. I don't know about you, but that is a prayer that I need daily. And secondly, he's praying that we will be united. That's the one prayer we could help answer ourselves. We could start praying for our friends. We could also pray for our church. And finally, we could pray for ourselves, that we will truly be strong and that we will always love one another. That's a prayer that aligns with God's will and is in the spirit of Jesus Christ. And we can know beyond the shadow of a doubt that God will be faithful to answer that prayer until the day we meet him face to face. Something to think about this day. Amen. May God's peace and love be with you now and forever.
By the power of the Holy Spirit, we bring our prayers before God, who promises to hear and answer in steadfast love. Take a moment for silent reflection. Holy God, in Christ Jesus, the joy of the church is made complete. Root the church in your word and unify us as Christ's body. Send us into the world as your loving people, ready to testify to your spirit at work. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Mighty God, the world is your handiwork, displaying your creative impulse. Seas teem with life, forests reach up to praise you, and the mystery of life lies deep in the soil. Guard and keep this world for the well-being of all of your creatures. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Gracious Sovereign, those who follow your ways are like trees planted near streams of water. establish the leaders of nations and all in authority in your grace and truth. Strengthen them so that the people they serve will have abundant life. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Generous Savior, you befriend those who are sick, suffering, poor, lonely, outcast, rejected, or sick. Grant healing and love to all in need, especially those that we name in your heart before you know. Give them tangible signs of your steadfast love. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Creator God, here in this community, we share the gift of praying, learning, and supporting one another. Give us thankful hearts as we claim the gifts that are unique to us, and keep us from being envious of others with different gifts. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Be with our church, this group of people that we call Bethesda. Let us be open to your words, that your voice may be a guide to us on our way on this journey of faith. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Saving God, your wonderful promise is the gift of eternal life in Jesus. Through the witness of those who have died in you, strengthen us now in this gift of life. We cherish the memory of your saints. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
In the hope of new life in Christ, we raise our prayers to you, trusting in your never-ending goodness and mercy, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Now we're going to have a communion that we do as a visitation team. So if you want to get your elements open, sometimes that's a challenge. Peace to you from our Lord Jesus Christ. When we gather for the celebration of Holy Communion, we hear again the story of God's mighty acts and the love shown us in the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. With thanksgiving, we remember that in the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and said to his disciples, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." We are given assurance of our Lord's presence through the gift of his Holy Spirit. Now that we have shared in the same bread of life and the same cup of blessing, you may be strengthened. As often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. Those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. Now please rise and let us join together in saying the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
wellspring of joy, through this meal you have put gladness in our hearts. Satisfy the hunger still around us, and send us as joyful witnesses that your love may bring joy to the hearts of all people. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May our glorious God grant you a spirit of wisdom to know and to love the risen Lord Jesus, the God of life, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Bless you now and forever. Amen. Amen. And we will close with Christ is Alive.
Christ is alive.
The good news. Alleluia.
Thanks be to God.